6. Question number 1. Okay. The velocity of a projectile equals its initial velocity at 2. They ask that, can we write the velocity of the projectile at any instant equal to the initial velocity at 2 something? A. A constant horizontal velocity. B. A constant vertical velocity. C. A constant increasing horizontal velocity. Or D. A constantly increasing downward velocity. We can say that a projectile is motion under the gravitational acceleration, right? The projectile is a motion under the gravitational acceleration, or under the G acceleration. But what is the difference between the projectile and the free fall? When we talk about the projectile and the free fall, the difference is that when we talk about the free fall, right, if we throw a ball upward and it goes downward, we don't have the horizontal initial velocity. If there is no horizontal initial velocity, it's a free fall. But for the projectile, we fire the ball with the initial velocity, right? And then it go like a parabola curve back to the ground again, okay? If we dissolve the motion into the horizontal motion and the vertical motion, we have a constant velocity for the horizontal motion, right? But we have a free fall in the vertical motion. So, projectile is a combination of the constant velocity motion in horizontal and the free fall in vertical. Okay? Now, if we write down the velocity at any instant, we have that Vx is equal to Vx0. Right? And Vy, since it's the same as the free fall in the vertical direction, so we have Vy 0 plus Gt. Okay? Now, let's take the upward direction as a positive direction. So we must have the negative sign here, right? we write out these two equation for the x component and y component of the velocity at any time, right? But if you want to write this as a vector, because we talk about the velocity, so if you want to write the velocity vector, right, you can see that we can write the velocity vector as Vxi plus Vyj. Okay? Here, the I is the unit vector in the x direction, right? And j is the unit vector in the y direction. Okay? So, we can write the velocity vector like this. Now, if we put Vx here and Vy here, we have is equal to Vx 0 I plus Vy 0 I minus GT, not I, this is J, Vy 0 J minus GT J. Right? So, when we look at the first two terms, if we look at these two terms, this equal to the initial velocity, right? It's Vx0 I plus Vy0 J, which is the initial velocity. So, you can see that the velocity vector can be written as the initial velocity minus GTJ. Okay? Minus GTJ like this. So, this term is a constant, which is the initial velocity, but the second term change in time and is increased, right? G is a gravitational acceleration, and when the time increase, this the magnitude of the second term increase, right? But we have the negative sign here. It means that it increased downward, right? Because we take the positive direction upward like this. So it means that the velocity increased downward. Okay, we add the initial velocity with the increasing velocity downward, right? So the answer is D, right? We have the initial velocity V0 and we add a constantly increasing downward velocity. A constantly increasing is mean that the rate of change of the velocity is constant, which equal to G, right? It's equal to G. So it's constantly increasing. And the minus sign here say that it's point downward. So the velocity increase downward, constantly increasing downward. Okay, the answer is D. Okay, so that is for the question number one. Question number two: an object is shot from the back of a railroad freight car moving at 40 km per hour on a straight horizontal road. The launcher is aimed upward, perpendicular to the bed of the freight car. The object falls A, in front of the freight car, B, behind the freight car, C, on the freight car, or D, either behind or in front of the freight car, depending on the initial speed of the object. Okay? We have a freight car, which we always use is as a cargo for the train, right? And they say that an object is chopped from the back of the railroad freight car, maybe the ball or maybe something sharp. The direction of the launcher. They say the launcher is aimed upward, perpendicular to the bed of the flat car. So it means that it aim to the launcher is aimed upward. Okay, it means that it want to shot to shoot the object upward, perpendicular to the flat car. Okay. But this relate to the or is this is a relative motion relate to the or respect to the flat car. But if you are an observer stand on the ground and you see this flat car move passing you, like this, it means that this object also has horizontal component, initial horizontal velocity component relative to you, right? When you look at the flat car, you look at this object, initially you see that this object has a horizontal velocity, okay? But relative to the person on the car, this object is at rest initially, right? And when they choose this object upward, okay? Relative to you, the object move in the projectile motion in the parabola curve. Okay. The question is that when it hit the ground or when it hit finally, it will hit the ground in front of the flat car, behind the flat car, or on the flat car. You can see that relative to the person on the ground, this object moves under the gravity, right? Move under the gravitational acceleration, which is point downward only. So this object has no horizontal acceleration, or we can say that this object moves with a constant velocity, horizontal velocity equal to Vx0. And this Vx0 is equal to the speed of the flat car, right? Because initially you see that this object move with the flat car, okay? So along its motion, it moves with the constant horizontal velocity, and the car moves with the same speed, right? So when it goes down to the ground again, it means that the horizontal horizontal distance that this object moves is equal to the horizontal distance that the car moves, right? Because it moves with the same speed. It means that the object will fall back to the same position on the car, right? Because it moves with the same speed. The distance that the car moves and the horizontal distance that the car moves and the horizontal distance that this object moves are the same, right? Because it moves with the same speed, Vx0. So it will go back to the same position. Relative to the person on the car, relative to the person on the car, the ball moves vertically only, right? When this person look at the ball, it moves vertical. Imagine that you are in a car and you throw a ball upward. You see the ball move upward vertically only, right? But the people on the ground, when it look into your car, it will see the ball move with the car. So it means that it has the horizontal motion also, right? But you see the ball move in the vertical motion only. So you can see that this object will go up and down back to the same position or go back to the launcher. Okay? So the answer is, on the flat car. In fact, to the same position when we launch the ball or the object. Okay, that is for the question number 2. Question number 3. And question number 3 to the question number 6 is a little bit complicated, but not that hard. Question number 3. A soccer player kicks a log horizontally off a 40-meter high cliff into a pool of water. If the player hears the sound of the splash 3 seconds later, what was the initial speed given to the rock? Assume the speed of sound in air is 343 meters per second. Okay? We have that a soccer player stand on a cliff. Okay? And it's a pool of water somewhere here. And he kicked a ball with some initial velocity. He kicked the ball horizontally. The ball moved horizontally initially with some initial velocity. And then the ball moved to the pool. And after that, the sound from the pool go back to the soccer. And he hear the sound after he kicked the ball 3 seconds. Okay? The question is that what is the value of Vx0? to solve this, first we can do this. The information we have is that the cliff is 40 meter high. Right? It's 40 meter high. And the soccer player kicked the ball horizontally. It moved horizontally at first. So we can say that vertically the ball is free fall vertically with zero initial velocity in the vertical direction. Right? The ball moves under the gravitational acceleration. Right? And we know the vertical distance. So we can calculate the time that the ball will hit the ground. Right? We can calculate the time that the ball hit the ground. We can use y equal to Vy0t I will call this T1 plus half of G T1 square. T1 is the time that the ball hit the ground. This is a T1, right? Okay? And we have that Vy0 is 0. And in this case, we use downward, positive direction, right? Because there is no point to use upward, positive direction. The ball goes downward only. So the most convenient way is to use the downward, positive direction. From this, we have that T1 is equal to 2y over g, square root of 2y over g, right? This is the time that the ball hit the ground. And next, when the ball hit the ground, which means the ball hit the pool, the sound moved from the pool back to the player. And we can assume that the sound will move with the constant speed, if we say it's a Vs, okay? And it takes the time T2, right? The total time T is equal to T1 plus T2, okay? And we know the total time. This is the total time. We know time T1. We can calculate time T1 from this. So it means that we can calculate time T2 equal to the total time minus T1, right? So we know the time T2. When we know the time T2, it means that we can calculate the distance if I call this S, the distance that the sound moves from the pool back to the player. So we have S is equal to Vs time T2, right? Once we know S, we know H, we can calculate the length of the motion or the horizontal distance, I call this R, right? We can see that R is equal to A square minus H square, and take the square root, right? From this triangle, we know S, we know H, so we can calculate R. And once we know the value of R, we know T1, right? We know T1. We have that R is equal to Vx0 T1, right? And we know T1, we know R, so it means that Vx0 is equal to R over T1, right? So we can calculate Vx0 from this, okay? But it's a little bit not complicated, but you have to do a little bit more about the arithmetic. So let's see. We have V0 equal to R over T1, right? We have Vx0 equal to R over T1. right? And R is equal to S minus S square. S square minus S square. And S is equal to VST2. And T2 is minus T minus T1. Is equal to T minus square root of 2y over t. Okay. It's not. In fact, if we use something like Excel to calculate this, it will be very convenient. Anyway, you are not allowed to take the computer, so we have to use the calculator. Start with the T2, right? So we have this equal to what? 3 seconds minus square root of 2 times 40. Over 9.8, right? So 3 seconds minus square root of 2 times 40 divided by 9.8 is equal to 0.143, right? 0.143 seconds. Okay, so we have T2. We have that T2 is 0.143 seconds. It's 0.1428 approximately equal 0.143 seconds. Okay. Now, we have T2, so S is equal to VS. VS is 3 equal to 49 meter, right? So we have S is 49 meter, and from S we can calculate R. R is equal to the 49 square minus 40 square and square root. Minus 40 square root of the answer is 48.59, right? So no. It's 48.999 square minus 40 square. I is 28.3 approximately, right? 28.3 meter. Okay, so we have VX0 is equal to divided by T1 is What is T1? Square root 2 times 40 divided by 0.8. So it's 9.9. Okay, it's about 9.91. It is a 9.905 or approximately 9.91 meter per second. We have the solution. The answer is 9.9 meter per second. Okay, this is a detailed calculation. Okay, that is for the question number 3. Okay, let's go to the question number 4. Question number 4, a projectile aims at the angle 60 degrees to the floor, okay, to a target hang from the ceiling. When the projectile is fired with the initial speed of 10 meters per second, the target is dropped vertically. If the ceiling is 5 meters high, the projectile will hit the target at the height h, where h is equal to what? A, B, C, or D. In this problem, you have a projectile, maybe the toy gun, aim at 60 degrees. To an object hang on the ceiling, okay? This object, okay? And when you fire this projectile, you drop this object, okay? So this object go down, and we find that the projectile hit the object at the height h. If we take the initial height of the object as a capital H like this, we want to know what is the value of h. Okay, we know this h is equal to 5 meters. Right? 5 meters, okay, this. How can we calculate this? Again, we can use the knowledge of the projectile motion, and especially we can dissolve the motion into horizontal component and the vertical component. Okay, they say that the initial speed of the projectile v, the magnitude of the initial speed is 10 meter per second. Okay, and it points 60 degrees above the ground. Okay, both the horizontal. So we can dissolve this into two components, Vx0 and Vy0. Right? And you can see that Vx0 is equal to V0 cos theta, right? We have this Vx0 equal to V0 cos theta. We know V0, right? We know theta 60 degree. So we can calculate Vx0. Okay. Now, we know that The object is at the initially it's at a 5 meter height like this. So if we look at the triangle, okay, and the length, the horizontal distance that the projectile moves, if I put this as an R, right, can see that tan theta is equal to H over R, right? We know theta, we know H, we know R, right? We know theta, we know H, we know R. Or we can write R is equal to the H over tan theta. And once we know R, it means that we can calculate the time of flight, right? We can calculate T. We can say that the time of flight, T, is equal to R over Vx0, or equal to R over V0 cos theta, right? Because we have only the vertical acceleration, the horizontal motion is has a constant velocity. So when we know the distance here, we can calculate the time, okay? And once we know the time, we can calculate the vertical distance that the object move, okay? So we have y is equal to vy0. This vy0 is a vertical component of the object, not of the projectile, okay? It's the safe length. Okay, I may write this as a, I use capital letter, Vy0 T plus half of G T squared, right? And we know that this capital Y0 is zero, so the first term vanished. So we have y equal to half of gt squared. Again, you can see that I use the positive sign here, right? Because I put a downward direction as a positive for this object. Okay, because we know that the object moves downward, so there is no point to use the upward direction as a positive direction. Okay. So from this point, we can calculate y. And finally, we can calculate the H. H will equal to H minus Y. Right? H is equal to the capital H minus Y. Okay? So that is the concept. That is the concept of solving this problem. Now, let's go to the detailed calculation. First, we calculate Vx0, right, which equal to V0 cos theta, which equal to V0 is what? Ten meter per second, right here. 10 meter per second, so it's equal to 10 times cos 60 degree. Okay, so what is the value? Ten times cos 60 is 5. Right? In fact, if you can remember the value of the trigonometry for some important angle, like 30, 45, 60, 8, 90, or 0. 90, 0 is simple, right? If you can remember the value, that's good. But for me, I don't have good memory anymore for my age. So I have to advise my calculator. Now you have Vx0, right? And next, calculate R, right? What is the value of R? R is equal to h over tan theta, right? It's equal to 5 over tan 60 degree. 5 over tan 60 is equal to 2.89 meter approximately. Okay, 2.89 meter approximately. So we know R. Next, once we know R, we can calculate T. Right? T is equal to R over Vx0. So T is equal to R over Vx0, which is equal to 10 times cos 60 is equal to 0 point approximately 0.577 seconds. Now, when we know T, we calculate Y. Okay? Y is equal to half of GT squared. So, Y is equal to half of GT squared, which is equal to half of 9.8 times 0.577 squared. Times 9.8 divided by 2. So it's 1.63, approximately 1.63 meter. So it means that H is equal to the capital H minus Y. So it's 5 minus 1.63. Okay? It's a 3.37 meter approximately. Okay. So the answer is 3.37, right? 3.37. So this is the answer. Okay. There is an interesting point for this question is that you will, when you fire the projectile, and at the instant that you fire the projectile, this object drop. The projectile will always hit the object. It's not depend on the velocity. But the height that the projectile hit the object depend on the initial velocity. You can change the value of the initial velocity. And you can see that it will always hit the object. But the height is here depend on the initial velocity. So let's try to prove this. Okay? Okay, that is for the question number 4. Let's go to the question number 5. It's quite a long question. A boy stands on a diving board and throws a stone into a swimming pool. The stone is thrown from a height of 2.5 meters above the water surface with a velocity of 4 meters per second at an angle of 60 degrees above horizontal. As a stone strikes the water surface, it immediately slows down to exactly half the speed it had when it struck the water and maintain the speed while in the water. Okay? After the stone enters the water, it moves in a straight line in the direction of the velocity it has when it struck the water. If the bottom, if the pool is 3 meters deep, how much the time between when the stone is thrown and when it strikes the bottom of the pool? How time between when the stone is thrown and when the it strikes? Okay, the is the total time. Okay. The problem is like this. A boy stands on a pool, the swimming pool, and it throw a ball, okay, a stone, throw from a height of 2.5 meters above the water surface. So water surface may be here, and a ball is thrown. Okay, they say that the V0, the magnitude of the initial velocity is 4 meters per second, and the angle theta is 60 degrees. Right? So we have a projectile motion, and the stone hit the water. And after that, they say that the stone go in a straight line. Okay, and hit the bottom of the pool. We have that, I may call this H1 equal to 2.5 meter. That is the height from the buoy to the water surface. And H2, which equal to 3 meters. From the water surface to the bottom of the pool. Okay? They ask the total time. Okay? They ask the total time, which we can say that it's the time T1 that the stone travel in the air, and the time T2 that the stone travel in the water, and the total time is T1 plus T2. Okay? T1 plus T2. Now, how can we calculate T1? How can we calculate T1? As we discussed in the test 5, the time of flight is determined by the vertical motion. Right? So if we dissolve the initial velocity into vertical and horizontal, we have Vx0 and Vy0. Okay? So we have Vy0 is equal to V0 sine theta. Right? We have Vy0 equal to V0 sine theta. We know the angle theta. We know the value of V0. So we know the Vy0. Okay? Now, what is the time T1? What is the time T1? We can use this formula, right? H1 equal to Vy 0 T1 plus half of GT1 square, right? We can use this formula. This is a height. Here, we take the downward positive direction. So we have this plus sign here. We take the downward positive because we know that at the end, the stone will go downward, right, with the distance 2.5 meter. So it's a convenient, the most convenient way, because if we put or we take the upward positive, we have to use H1 as a minus 2.5 meter. That is okay, you can do that, but I think it's not convenient, right? So from this, we can calculate T1 by solving this quadratic equation, okay? Next, we have to calculate T2. And in the question, they say that after the ball struck the water, it goes in the straight line, right? With the velocity, which is the half of the impact velocity here, right? So what we have to find here is that what is the impact velocity? What is the value of V here? We know that, or we can write this as a V at T1. V at T1 is equal to the Vx square plus Vy square and square root, like this. Okay? But we also know that Vx is equal to Vx0, right? We know that Vx is equal to Vx0. And Vy, we can calculate Vy in many ways. Here, if we know the value of T1, okay, we can calculate Vy as Vy0 minus GT1. Be careful on this step. You can see that here, I use a positive sign here, right, to calculate T1. But here I use a negative sign for G. You can also use a positive sign here. If you use the positive sign here, it means that you have to use the negative sign for Vy0. Because the initial velocity, the vertical initial velocity point upward, and if you use downward as a positive, you have to use this as a negative. But I use here for the convenience because I want to know only the value of Vy. Right? Now, you can see that you will have Vy here as a negative value. Okay? So it's up to you. I may put this as an option. Like, I can write this as a minus Vy0 plus GT1. This way, you will get the positive value of for Vy, but this way, you will get a negative value for Vy, right? But for any value, you will get the same value of V here, because you have to take the square of Vy, right? So you will have V equal to Vx square plus Vy square and square root. You will get the same value. whether VY is positive or negative. Okay, so you can use both method. Depend on you. Depend what which one that convenient you the most. Now, we know the magnitude of the velocity, but what we have to know also is the direction, right? So we have Vx, we have Vy. So if we write down the triangle, okay, you can calculate the angle theta here. Oh, I may put this at angle phi to separate from the theta here. Okay, to separate from the theta here. You can see that we have tan phi equal to Vy over Vx, right? This Vy, this Vx. So we know we can, from this, we can calculate the value of phi, okay? And we know the depth of the pool. We know H2. Right? In fact, we don't have to know this, right? We don't have to know the angle here. Okay, so you can ignore this step. Because we know H2, right? And we know Vy. So we can calculate T2 from H2 over Vy, right? It's not necessary to know this direction. Okay, so it's good. You can ignore this step. Okay, so you have T2 equal to H2 over Vy. And once you know T2, once you know T1, you can calculate the total time. Okay, you can calculate the total time. I will leave this for you because you already submit your answer, but you can use this to check whether the answer is correct or not, because the detailed calculation require a little bit long and it's almost 12:30. Okay, so go back and calculate, do the detailed calculation. Calculate T1 from this, calculate T2 from this, and calculate the total time from this. Okay? Now, let's go to the question number 6. Length the launch angles for the 5 paths in the figure below with respect to time of flight from the shortest time of flight to the longest. Okay, it means that if you launch a projectile with the same initial velocity, the magnitude of the initial velocity is, for example, 50 meters per second. Which path will take the longest time? Which path will take the longest time? Which path will take the longest time? Okay? So, which one that this mean the, which direction or which component of the motion that determine the time of flight, as we discussed before. The time of flight will be determined from the vertical component of the motion, right? It will be determined by the vertical component of the motion, okay? So if we know that all of these 5 projectiles have the same initial velocity, so which one take the largest time, which one take the smallest time. Let's see. We want to see, we want to calculate the time of flight, right? We have the initial velocity, V0, which equal to 50 meters per second. So we can calculate Vx, which Vx0, which equal to V0 cos theta, right? And we can calculate Vy0, which equal to V0 sin theta. Okay, we have V0 and angle theta here. So we have Vx0 and Vy0, like this. Okay, now we want to determine the time of flight. We can use this relation. Y equal to Vy0 minus half of G, Vy0 T minus half of G T square. Here, I put the upward direction as a positive direction. Why is the vertical distance for the projectile? Right? Why is the vertical distance for the projectile? Okay? And the time of flight is the time when the projectile go back to the ground. Right, the projectile go back to the ground, which means that in this case, y is equal to 0. Right, y is equal to 0 because it starts from the ground and then go back to the ground. So y is equal to 0. So we have 0 is equal to Vy0t minus half of g T square, and you can cancel this T. So we have that half of G T equal to Vy0, which means that T is equal to 2 Vy0 over G. Right? Am I correct? Correct? Okay. You put y equal to 0 here, so you can cancel this t, and you have 2Vy0 over g. Or we can write t equal to 2Vy0 is equal to V0 sin theta over G, right? We have time of flight equal to 2V0 sin theta over G. G is a constant. V0 are the same for all projectiles. So it means that time of flight depends on sin theta. Now, you can see that theta go from what? 15, right? 15 degree to 75 degree. Okay, but we know that psi function increase with the angle, right? Psi 0 is 0, psi 90 degree is 1, right? So psi theta increase from 15 to 30 to 45 to 60 to 75. So The time of flight is greatest at 75 degrees and smallest at 15 degrees, right? Okay? Am I correct? So, if they ask the time of flight from the shortest time to the longest time, the answer should have to be B, right? Okay, because it depends on the angle theta here. Okay, so we have the answer of this question is B. Okay, I left this calculation, detailed calculation to do. Just check that if your answer agree with this calculation or not. Okay, so that's all for today. Any question? So if there's no question, let's see next Tuesday. เจอกันวันอังคารหน้านะครับ